Le 12h sur la CRTV, mesdames et messieurs, bienvenue à tous. Bonjour Elvis.
Hello, Cassie.
Vous avez les titres de ce journal.
There are Christians pray for God's divine intervention to end the COVID-19 and restore peace and security in regions affected by socio-political crisis at the time when the Muslim community engages in the last 5 days of fasting and prayers of the month of Ramadan, marked by the reopening of the Ngaoundere Central Mosque and focus on exams on CRTV radio and television has officially come to an end. Lectures for examination classes will be made available to students. This has been announced by the Minister of Secondary Education, Professor Pauline Nalova-Lyonga, who is guest on this edition of the Midday Bilingual News on the CRTV. Thanks for staying tuned. Those are our top stories. The news begins in the French language with Cathy Toulou.
Ouvrant cette édition du 12h par cette messe d'action de grâce dite par l'archevêque métropolitain de Yaoundé, Monseigneur Jean Barga. C'était à la basilique Marie-Reine des Apôtres de Vaulier ce matin. C'est une messe spéciale pour les 48 ans de l'État unitaire et les 60 ans de l'indépendance du Cameroun. L'archevêque a invité les fidèles à prier pour la paix. Il appelle également la population à lutter contre le coronavirus à travers la prière et la vie spirituelle. Et nous poursuivons cette édition avec le nouveau président de la Chambre d'agriculture, des pêches, de l'élevage et des forêts, Roland Mata, qui est aux commandes. Le président de cette chambre consulaire a pris fonction vendredi au cours d'une cérémonie présidée par le ministre de l'Agriculture, Gabriel Bayrobé, et qui a demandé au nouveau promu de s'investir pleinement pour dynamiser cette structure restée orpheline depuis la disparition de Janvier Mungi Sosomba. Marlise Enouambarga.
Ensemble, prions pour le Cameroun. Together, let's pray for Cameroun. Le caractère bilingue de ce thème interpelle tous les compatriotes sans exclusion. Sur les uniformes aux couleurs du drapeau national, il est mentionné « Je suis Cameroun ». Une 13e édition dont le menu s'inspire du contexte sociopolitique interne.
Aujourd'hui, le Cameroun est confronté à la crise socio-économique et socio-politique du Nord et du Sud-Ouest. Nous avons beaucoup de gens qui continuent à sévir, malgré qu'il a été réduit à son plus simple expression au fil des années. Mais nous prions pour que cette agression dans notre partie septentrionale s'arrête aussi. Au sorti du Covid, on ne sait pas ce qui va se passer. Nous avons lu les centaines de milliards que l'État est en train de perdre. Comment le Cameroun va-t-il survivre après ?
Dans le respect littéral des exigences gouvernementales, chants et prières ont été dits, en incluant la distanciation sociale, comme quoi l'Église se soumet aux autorités, le regard tourné vers le ciel.
Quand vous regardez à l'environnement, tout s'est arrêté. La politique, les affaires, tout semble être confiné, mais Dieu n'est pas confiné. Les Camerounais et la diaspora sont également en ce moment en train de prier, aux États-Unis, en France, au Canada.
Cette journée nationale de prière est simultanément organisée dans les 10 métropoles du pays sans discrimination d'obédience religieuse.
And that was the National Day of Prayers that's organized yesterday in Douala, in the littoral region. And in Yaoundé, a special mass has been celebrated at the Mary Queen of Victory Cathedral by His Grace Jean Barga, Metropolitan Archbishop of Yaoundé, to mark the 60th anniversary of Cameroon's independence and the 48th anniversary of its unity. The bishop called on Cameroonians to be disciplined, prayerful, and hardworking as a means of fighting the COVID-19 pandemic. Let's have a listen to the bishop in his interview granted to him by Alice B.
This solemn day, the day of the Mass of the Nation, we have celebrated the grace of 60 years of independence of our country and the grace of the 48 years of national unity. In this same occasion, we have honored the Lady, the Virgin Mary, King of the Apostles. These three dimensions of this celebration were to help us to pray against the pandemic COVID-19 and to invite all the faithful and all the citizens to be mobilized to face this pandemic with all our energy. At the same time, we have prayed to the resumption of the normal activity, the schools, the offices, and many jobs we are doing now. We ask God to bless it, to help the people to continue to live. And in this occasion, we say that three words, three mottos are very important for us: the spirituality, the discipline, and the resumption of work.
And that was the Metropolitan Archbishop of Yaoundé, His Grace Jean Baga. Another place where there was prayers also is at the minaret of the Grand Mosque of the Lamidat of Ngaoundéré, which has been reopened for Friday prayers. This after about 2 months of closure due to preventive measures for the COVID-19. Our reporter Silas Nkwine, reported the spiritual leader of Ngaoundéré, was also part of the opening Friday prayers.
The landmark of the Adamawa capital is the minaret of the Grand Mosque of the Lamidat of Ngaoundéré. Friday prayers here is a must for many Muslims faithful. After being banned for more than a month due to coronavirus-led measures, the prayers resumed in the mosque with minimal risk conditions for spreading the virus.
It is since 7 or 8 Friday we have not done prayer for Friday. And today when we are doing the prayer, respect the distanciation, 1 meter, everybody.
During the prayer led by Imam Mahamud Ali in the presence of Ngaoundéré's highest spiritual leader, the Lamido Mohamadou Hayatou Issa, worshippers were encouraged to maintain social distancing and wear protective masks even as they will continue to pray and fast during this Ramadan period in this area with a Muslim majority for a global victory over the pandemic. Religious sites in the Adamawa region were closed off recently when the government announced a series of measures to curb the virus. According to Muslims faithful, Islam doesn't permit practices that would put human life in danger.
Dans le reste de l'actualité, la commune de Ngoulmakan, dans le sud, vient de tenir son conseil municipal. Le compte administratif du maire a été arrêté au cours des travaux où on a constaté que le taux d'exécution du budget d'investissement public s'élève à 74%. Eric Asako, CRTV Sud.
Selon le patron de l'Anvila, la commune de Ngoulmakan, porte d'entrée de la région du sud, lorsqu'on vient de Yaoundé, se démarque en matière de gouvernance locale. 74% de taux d'exécution du budget d'investissement public en 2019 et un prix d'excellence au guichet de performance PNDP Banque mondiale. Le compte administratif du maire et les projets ficelés pour l'année en cours augurent encore de belles perspectives dans cette municipalité.
Nous voulons toujours aller plus loin. Nous pensons que si nous avons pu glaner des lauriers en 2019, que 2020 nous apporte un peu plus. Et comme on a changé le conseil avec des hommes nouveaux, avec des compétences nouvelles, plus élargies, on espère que les lendemains nous seront meilleurs.
Le conseil municipal a donné l'occasion au préfet de l'Anvila d'inviter l'exécutif communal à fructifier davantage les niches fiscales pour accroître ses revenus.
Il faut qu'on atteigne le stade de 100 boutiques. Pour qu'on puisse parler d'un marché qui est prospère, il faut qu'on puisse aller à la mise en place des unités de transformation de produits comme le latex, provision de l'EVA à Ngoulmakan.
Pour le maire de Ngoulmakan, la tâche est immense. Les habitants sont appelés à respecter les mesures anti-Covid-19 pour empêcher au virus de nuire à la réalisation de tous les projets d'envergure prévus par la mairie.
You are watching the Midday Balinga News on the CRTV. A consignment of sanitary kits worth 10 million civil francs has been donated to the Muslim community in Cameroon to help fight the spread of the COVID-19 pandemic. The donation was made by the Council of Imams and Muslim Dignitaries of Cameroon, CIDIMOUC, and its partners. Romeo Kenye has details.
Over 1,500 pieces of soap, 700 hand-washing mobile points, more than 1,000 hydroalcoholic solutions, plus protective face masks worth some 10 million CFA francs. These are sanitary kits donated by the Council of Imams and Religious Dignitaries of Cameroon Sidimuk to all Muslim communities in the country to help curb the spread of the dreaded COVID-19 pandemic. A gesture set to be timely.
This is also to show that even the imams and the Muslims, they are also in collaboration with the government in fighting the COVID-19. It's also to tell you that COVID-19 is not just for particular people.
The move is supported by UN Women, EIE Cameroon, UNPA, and the Minister of Women's Empowerment and the Family.
With this important stock of materials, it will help the sensitive strata of the population to fight COVID-19, which is a reality. It is not an imagination. And each of us should really do everything to sensitize around.
This action, according to members of CIDIMIC, is their own way to help government set the coronavirus at bay in Cameroon.
And Romeo Kenye will not be leaving us as he is going to be reporting on the three officials appointed at the Ministry of Higher Education who have been installed and challenged to foster professionalization in Cameroon's higher education. They were installed by the Secretary General of the Ministry of Higher Education, Professor William Gapsa, as Romeo Kenye once again.
One Inspector General, two inspectors in charge of academic affairs, installed by the Secretary General at the Minister of Higher Education, Professor Wilfred Gapsa, personal representative of the Minister of State, Minister of Higher Education. The newly installed officials have as mission assist the state in the professionalization process of higher education in the country.
There are basic principles that have to be respected within the administration to help the Minister of State, Minister of Higher Education fulfill the delicate mission that has been conferred upon him by the President of Public Head of State by appointing him the head of this ministerial department. And as I said, the three major canon principles that are following are principles of quality assurance, the principle of the professionalization of higher education teaching, and the principle of employability of higher education graduates.
With commitment and determination, they are upbeat to meet up their expectations.
The new challenge, it will be to make my job very well, to be engaged, to be to have determination, to make a good job for the improve of this higher system education.
The three newly installed were appointed last May 8 by a prime ministerial decree.
Coming up after this newscast is CITV's Most Watched Debate program, Press Hour, with Joe Chiwonken Kalabupsa. And we now hook up with Studio 4 to meet Joe Chiwonken. Hello, Joe. Could you tell us what are the topics for today's debate on the program?
Good day, TK. Welcome to Studio 4. The challenge is there and the danger is still real. And so the fight against COVID-19 is ongoing. It hasn't reduced the least in Cameroon, just as we find around the world. So we still focus on it. And today we'll try to look at the African approach to COVID-19. Can Africans provide a solution? It's already making news and curing people across the African continent. So what is available? We have an expert in medicinal plants. We have an epidemiologist. We have a media consultant to do that with us on the program this midday. So rendezvous in under 30 minutes when you wrap up your news. I say under 15 minutes or so. Over to you, Studio 5.
Thank you. And we continue the news with you, Cathy.
Retour sur cette actualité relative au nouveau président de la Chambre d'agriculture, des pêches, de l'élevage et des forêts, Roland Matta, qui est désormais aux commandes. Le président de cette chambre consulaire a pris fonction cette fin de semaine au cours d'une cérémonie présidée par le ministre de l'Agriculture, Gabriel Bayrobé, et qui a demandé au promu de s'investir pleinement pour dynamiser cette structure restée orpheline depuis la disparition de Janvier Mungi Sosomba. Marlise et Noa Barga.
Une nouvelle page s'est ouverte ce vendredi à la Chambre d'agriculture, des pêches, de l'élevage et des forêts. Nommé par un décret présidentiel le 8 mai dernier, Joseph Roland Matta trône depuis ce jour au poste de président. Ancien secrétaire d'État aux forêts et ancien sénateur, il n'arrive pas en terrain inconnu.
Je vais faire tous les efforts possibles pour mériter la confiance qui a été placée en moi par son Excellence le président de la République, Paul Biya.
Fils de l'Amboubaï Ngoko, à l'est de Cameroun, il jouit d'une parfaite connaissance des missions qui lui sont désormais assignées. En l'installant dans ses nouvelles fonctions, le ministre de l'Agriculture et du Développement Rural, Gabriel Mbaïrobé, l'a invité à mettre sa riche expérience au service de cette structure, tombée en hibernation depuis la disparition de Janvier Monguiso Somba il y a 2 ans et conduite jusqu'à ce jour par le vice-président Moussa Nkwé. De son côté, Joseph Roland Matta, qui mesure l'immensité de sa tâche, s'est dit prêt à relever le défi.
Je suis un champion du relèvement des défis. Je le ferai avec tous les corps sociaux. Je le ferai avec la collaboration de mes pairs pour que nous menions à terme et à bon terme cette mission qui est exaltante.
Le nouveau président de la Chambre d'agriculture, Joseph Roland Matta, né le 13 février 1961, est marié et père de 5 enfants.
On va parler à présent d'un nouveau promu. Le président de la République a signé en début de semaine de décret l'un portant nomination d'un président du conseil d'administration à la navette et l'autre décret portant nomination du président du conseil d'administration de l'ARMP porterait ce dimanche d'Aliou Dewa, le nouveau PCA de l'ARMP qui a une mission importante dans la régulation des marchés publics. Michel Renaud, Ouandja.
Depuis sa nomination lundi dernier, à la suite du décret présidentiel, le domicile d'Aliou Dewa, président du conseil d'administration de l'ARMP, ne désemplit pas. D'ailleurs, les appels téléphoniques depuis cette nomination font également partie du quotidien de ces natifs de Mayo Darlé, dans la Damawa.
Mais je voudrais d'abord commencer par dire merci au Tout-Puissant Dieu, par qui tout doit être possible. Au président de la République, qui a bien voulu porter son choix sur ma modeste personne.
Marié et père de nombreux enfants, l'administrateur civil principal, âgé de 58 ans, mesure le poids de ses nouvelles responsabilités.
Président du conseil d'administration, ça veut dire qu'il y a les membres de ce conseil d'administration, avec la direction générale de l'ARMP et son personnel. Nous allons nous mettre au travail pour relever le défi. Le défi qui est dans le secteur de la régulation des marchés publics.
Petit d'expérience, celui qui officiait il y a 2 mois comme directeur des affaires générales au ministère des marchés publics est connu pour sa loyauté.
Il a été mon collaborateur, mon chef de service pendant près de 6 ans au contrôle provincial des finances, où il s'est manifesté par sa compétence, par sa disponibilité.
Commandeur de l'Ordre de la Valeur, Aliou Dewa est sur le plan politique, membre du comité central et président de la section RDPC, Mayo Banyosan.
We now take you to the South region to see Sangmili Mine, the Jah and Lobo is today referred to as the hub of social cohesion. For Cameroonians, inhabitants of the town say the cord of unity is stronger than division amongst Cameroonians from different ethnic groups and various backgrounds who live together harmoniously. Clarence Azzi has more.
Sangmilima, chief town of the Jah and Lobo division of the South region, is one of those towns in Cameroon highly reputed as the melting pot of national integration. Here one finds Cameroonians from all over cohabiting peacefully.
Peace is running. Just this a bit pandemic that come now and be disturbing us about the market, but it's going. Even though we are not in our region, but I think we are in peace now.
Like children of the same family, there are often tense moments between inhabitants, though not stronger than the cords of love that bind them together.
I can say peace is running and we are living fine without no any problem again. With the new mayor, just his encouragement, you feel like you are at home in this place.
Cameroonians from other parts of the country residing in Sangmilima are fully involved in the management of the town. Many of them are even occupying posts at the council.
We don't have any problem in our town. We work together, we live together. It's normal to have sometimes the small problem. This problem gives us the possibility to stay to find the solution about the construction of our town.
The beautiful town is just Cameroon in miniature, thanks to the melange of the different communities residing in the Jai and Lobo divisional headquarters.
As announced in the headlines, 200 lectures were given within 6 weeks on television and radio to students of examination classes in the primary and secondary levels of education in both the English and the French subsystems. Our guest on this edition of the news is the Minister of Secondary Education, Professor Pauline Naluva Lyonga, who was received last night on the 7:30 news by a colleague, and she evaluated the distance learning program Focus on Exams on CRTV television, radio, and web. Let's listen to that conversation.
You know, this is not the end of it, because every child should be able to have it. So it is there. That's why we're sending it everywhere. And that's why it is on social media as well. And we're sure that the children are going to have it and that they will do well. We're expecting, I mean, let me go even further to say that we're expecting very good results at the GCE this year, because they have several opportunities for them to do their revision and to do well.
And the distance learning on CRTV, actually the end of it actually coincided with the announcement for the tentative resumption of schools on the 1st of June for pupils of examination classes. What can you tell us about this resumption?
The resumption is going to be difficult. It's not going to be easy, because once again we're coming up with we're going to face a situation that we have not faced before. Fortunately, we have had to cut down on the number of pupils who will be present in school. That is only those in the examination classes. So that gives us the opportunity to do social distancing, because we can now use those teachers who are in the intervening classes, and they will be able to do the supervision, etc., and we shall have more classrooms to do that. So because of that, that is going to be easy. And because everybody is enthusiastic to participate and do something positive, you know, everybody is anxious to fight against this virus, I think that is going to be fine, because all the parents wish that every child who goes to school come 1st of June is going to be safe.
What are some of these measures that you'll be putting at the level of secondary education and why not even basic education to ensure that the pupils and the teachers are safe while they're at school?
I will say that people should not be afraid, but rather that people should effect the measures that the Prime Minister is talking about every day, almost, so to speak. You know, if you do what you know you're supposed to do, then you should not be afraid. Wear our masks, wash our hands, use hand sanitizers, get all our toilets and everything very clean. You know, as you know, the Clean School campaign is something which we've been doing in secondary schools. If you go to some of those secondary schools that are actually doing it, you'll be surprised to see how neat the schools are. So we just continue along these lines, and we will be fine.
Is there any inspection that your ministry is envisaging before the school resumption to ensure that all schools have water, because the children must wash their hands?
Yes. Not only that, we're going to have orientation, and we'll be working with the Ministry of Health and also with a lot of our partners.
What are some of the lessons you've learned, and what are you going to be envisaging with the setbacks?
Yes. Well, we're hoping that the thing about lights will improve. But the problem is that if you don't have lights, no problem, because you're going to be able to go somewhere where you can download this material. And of course, you can go somewhere where you can charge your phone, you know, and have the material in your phone and do that.
Your last word, Professor?
Well, my last word is that I hope that the government will continue its interest in this, and that we can continue to use the experience that CRTV has had and the experience that those teachers who were trained have had, so that we can fight this virus again come September, because I'm afraid that in September we'll have a bigger and more difficult task, because this time it's not just the examination classes, but it's the whole school. So we're having everybody come in, but social distancing has to be observed. How can we do that? Can we use distance education to improve on this situation? I hope we can. It will be important that we do so.
le professeur Nalova Lyonga, ministre des enseignements secondaires, qui a par ailleurs assisté hier à la clôture du télé-enseignement sur la CRTV. Et maintenant, en page magazine, allons à présent à Foulassi, c'est dans la région du Sud. Là-bas, c'est le berceau de l'hymne national du Cameroun, la salle qui porte la mémoire de cet emblème rafraîchi par le gouvernement. Replongeons dans l'histoire avec Georges Di.
Niché dans un écrin de verdure, Foulassi, l'une des stations missionnaires presbytériennes américaines, est un témoin privilégié de l'histoire du Cameroun. Dans ces bâtiments emblématiques et vastes jardins de fruits sont passés deux adolescents, René Jamafane et Samuel Minkyo Mbamba, qui ont écrit en lettres d'or les strophes et les notes d'une inspiration éternelle, le chant des ralliements devenu plus tard l'hymne national du Cameroun.
C'est ici alors qu'il y avait des salles de classe pour l'école normale. C'est dans ce bâtiment que René Jamafane et son équipe ont eu à créer l'hymne national.
Un parcourant ce site mythique de plus de 100 hectares résonne toujours l'écho de l'union sacrée des fils et filles du Cameroun, du nord au sud, de l'est à l'ouest.
C'était juste l'école primaire de Foulassi. Aujourd'hui, c'est la faculté de sciences à l'éducation. Ils ont un effectif de près de 50 étudiants.
Foulassi accuse l'usure du temps et l'oubli. Il reste très mal connu des Camerounais. D'où la nécessité d'une action coordonnée entre l'église presbytérienne camerounaise et le gouvernement pour sauver de la ruine ce patrimoine national.
Le gouvernement doit préserver cette station où est né l'hymne de la République, quand lui-même peut se décider de réaliser sans plus passer par personne interférée.
Foulassi ne retrouvera peut-être plus son lustre d'antan, mais doit rester en vie pour perpétuer l'esprit d'unité de génération en génération.
All those beautiful pictures and sound music from Foulassi put an end to this edition of the Midday Balinga News on the CRTV. Thanks for watching. Immediately coming up after this is Press R, and Katia and myself will be here again next Sunday. Have a nice week.
Merci. Bonne semaine à vous.